Good afternoon, everyone. This is Mr. Sangyappu Kirti Kumar, Senior Nursing Officer, Critical Intensive Care Unit, All India Institute of Medical Science, Bhubaneswar. Today's topic, care of ventilator patients, fast heart beat. Have you given to fast track your patient? Yes, we have to give fast track in each and every shift in a day. Coming to the objective of the session, at the end of the session, participants will be able to understand and perform the COVID ICU nursing care with improved confidence. Let us discuss about components of fast HUGS beat in our intensive care unit. Feeding and fluids, analgesia, sensorium and sedation, thromboembolic prophylaxis, head up position, ulcerative prophylaxis, glycemic control, supplementation of oxygen, spontaneous breathing trial, bowel care, indwelling catheter, drug de-escalation. Let us see need purpose of fast HUGS beat. Improve quality of patient care, increases safety and efficiency of patient care, helps not to forget general aspects of patient care, to encourage teamwork as well as nurses we are doing in intensive care unit. Let us discuss about first one, that is feeding. And mainly feeding issues is malnutrition can lead to impaired immune function and it leads to increased susceptibility to infection, poor wound healing, loss of muscle mass, bacterial overgrowth in the GI tract, prolonged ICU and hospital length in stay. These will lead to feeding issues. Let's really see feeding needs. To meet nutrient demands of the patient in our ICU, there are two methods. One is enteral feeding and second one is parenteral feeding. While coming to the enteral feeding, in our COVID ICU, ventilator patients, we have to start feeding within 24 hours. So through nasopharynx tube or oropharyngeal tube. First of all, we have to start clear liquid diet followed by high protein diet because to improve muscle mass and faster extubation. Coming to the non-invasive ventilation, that patient who are in NIV mask or oxygen mask. After extubation, we have to start feeding within 3 hours while because it will prevent aspiration. And coming to the liquid diet, we have to give encourage to patient to take liquids and then gradually we have to give normal diet as per diabetic or non-diabetic and encourage patient to take high protein diet to avoid ICU stays for a prolonged time. Coming to the second, parenteral nutrition. To parenteral nutrition, mainly we have to give those who are not taking RT feed for last 7 days, basically we will consider as total parenteral nutrition. And note, fast IV infusion or parenteral nutrition, it will lead to hyperglycemia. Coming to the nurse's role, that is our role. Everybody has knows that head end should be elevated about 30 to 45 degree to prevent aspiration and pneumonia. While giving feed, we have to check the rails to fixation, whether it is properly fixed or not, and tolerating. And before giving feed, you have to aspirate and see whether the feed is tolerating or not. After giving feed, flush with normal saline or water to prevent any blockages or not. Coming to analgesia, the main allergy issues are it can lead to unwanted and prolonged endotracheal intubation. And analgesia needs optimize patient comfort, minimize the acute stress response, that is hypermetabolism and increase oxygen consumption. And pain in different forms like illness, it will lead to pain obviously. And devices, when we are doing endotracheal intubation or suctioning, it will lead to pain. And coming to the procedures, IV cannulation, Ryle's tube, suctioning, and any central line procedures, it will lead to pain. And coming to the nurse's role, that is our role. Pain should be assessed regularly with visual analysis scale, that is VAS, and critical care pain observation tool, that is CCPOT. In visual analog scale, the score will be 0 to 10. So in this, we have to maintain below 3, that is mild pain. In critical care pain observation tool, same the score should be 0 to 8. In this, we have to maintain at least 3. And coming to the medications to decrease pain, we have to give first line drugs is injection, paracetamol and tramadol. If pain is not subsiding, then we have to go for injection, phentalin and morphine. And the next one is sedation. Mainly the sedation issues, over sedation causing respiratory distress and hypotension. Prolonged ventilation can lead to nasocomial infection also. So sedation needs, basically it will control agitation, prevent accidental extubation and control intracranial pressure and reduce metabolism. Coming to the nurse's role, that is our role, ensure intubated patients have adequate depth of sedation with calm, comfortable and collaborative levels. Ensure the sedation we have to assess with GCS, that is Glasgow Coma Scale, and Richmond Agitated and Sedation Scale, that is RAS, for intubation solely. In GCS components, there are three main components. One is eye opening, verbal response and motor response. In eye opening, the scale should be 1 to 4, and verbal response, the scale should be 1 to 5, and motor response, the scale should be 1 to 6, as shown in the brief. In the RAS, RAS mainly to prevent agitation of the patient. So in these, the score will be 0 to plus 4 and 0 to minus 5, because to prevent self-extubation and agitation. And mainly the drugs what we are using in these, infusions like fentanyl infusion, midazolam infusion and dexamethasone infusion, mainly to prevent self-extubation of the patient. Moving to thromboembolic prophylaxis. And in this, the main issues are prolonged stay in intubated or bedridden patients in ICU can lead to thromboembolism. And mainly it needs to prevent deep vein thrombosis like DVT and pulmonary embolism, that is PE. It should be implemented as soon as possible, first 24 hours when we are reaching the patient, to prevent venous thromboembolism. Coming to the nurse's role, to prevent DVT, graduate compression stockings or intermittent pneumatic compression devices, that is IPC, and thin-length elastic compression stockings, sequential compression devices we have to give. And coming to the pharmacological actions, some drugs are there like clexin and heparin, it will prevent DVT. Coming to the head up position. In head up position, main issues are aspiration and ventilator associated pneumonia, that is VAP. And need of head elevation is, elevate the head should be 30 to 45 degree angle, reduce the occupancy of gastrointestinal reflex and prevent changes of aspiration during enteral feeding and nasocomial pneumonia. In nurse's role, ensuring head end should be elevated 30 to 45 degree while giving RHU feed to prevent aspiration, and bed should be elevated 30 degree for tolerance. And mainly in neurosurgery patients, the post procedure patients like EVD, so in that the ICP pressure will increase. To avoidance of that, we have to elevate head at least 30 to 45 degree elevation. And coming to next, ulcer prophylaxis. In ulcer prophylaxis, main issues are mucosal damage, significant bleeding, incident of gastrointestinal bleeding ranges from 1.5 to 8.5, and it may reaches to 15% also. And main ulcerative prophylaxis needs are to prevent gastrointestinal bleeding, prevent stress ulcers in ICU. Coming to the nurse's role, ensure patient is receiving stress ulcer prophylaxis or not. For prevention of that, we have to give histamine 2 receptor blockers, that is injection ranitidine or tablet ranitidine, and proton pump inhibitors like injection pan or tablet pan. And we have to give the sucralfate fat syrup also. And coming to the glycemic control. In glycemic control, main issues are insulin deficiency is associated with diabetic ketoacidosis, hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia can lead mortality length of stay and infection in ICU patients. And mainly the glycemic needs are, it helps mainly to avoid complications such as decreased wound healing, increased infection rate, and it increases risk of polyneuropathy. Coming to the nurse's role, ensure that patient is getting insulin or not. In our code ICU, there are ventilator patients or non-ventilator patients. In ventilator patients, we will give insulin like infusion. So how to prepare infusion? We will take 50 ml syringe, 50 ml NS followed by 50 units insulin. So for example, patient RBS levels are 250, we have to divide it by 100, that is 2.5 ml per hour we are giving. And normal patients, the target level is below 180. So if patient RBS is more than 180, we have to give subcutaneous injection as per doctor's recommendation. Coming to the spontaneous breathing trial and supplementation of oxygen. The main spontaneous breathing trial issues are prolonged days in intubated patients. And what is the need? The positive pressure type of ventilation, reduced prolonged length of ICU stays. When patient needs further ventilation care or planned for extubation and trial for TBs, we have to ensure that patient is taking respiratory rate is normal or not. Coming to the nurse's role, in our COVID ICU, ventilator patient and non-ventilator patients are there. So in ventilator patients, mainly the trial should be synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation to spontaneous mode. In that spontaneous mode, gradually we have to decrease pressure support and minimum should be 8, and positive end expiratory pressure minimum should be 5, and FiO2 minimum we have to keep 35, and after that we have to do 1 APG and we have to see continuous saturation and we have to plan for extubation. And next, NIV support. In NIV support, mainly we have to see pressure support ventilation and FiO2. Gradually we have to decrease pressure support and we have to remove NIV mask and we have to keep high flow concentration mask, that is 10 liters oxygen, and gradually we have to decrease oxygen with normal mask, and after that we have to keep nasal prones with 2 liters and we have to take 1 APG and we have to wean off completely oxygen. That is our nurse's goal. And come to the next, bowel care. The bowel care main issues are diarrhea. It can lead to electrolyte imbalances also. And next one is dehydration and constipation. This is the most issues we are facing in our ICU. And what is the need? What is the patient needs? We have to encourage more to take fluids and we have to give diet as per bowel incontinence, and suppositories and enema we can encourage to take, and abdominal massage like hot water bag application also we can give. And coming to the nurse's role, look for abdominal distension, auscultation of presence of bowel sounds or not, and palpate for tenderness, tightness and rigidity. Observe any mucus or blood present in the stool, that we have to see clearly, and document passes, stool, bowel and open quality, nature of the fecus. Mainly in our nurse's role, for the constipations we can encourage more amount of fluids, and if the constipation is not reducing, we can give enema and proctolitis syrup also. And next one is indwelling catheter. In indwelling catheter, main issues are nosocomial infections or complications like catheter associated urinary tract infection, that is CUTI, or central line association bloodstream infections. And main needs to remove all lines as soon as possible to avoid infection, that is peripheral line, Foley's catheterization, central line and arterial line. Is there any spinal line? That also we can remove. And coming to the nurse's role, mainly we have to focus on sites, that is in subcutaneous we have to see any subcutaneous injection swelling or not, like any redness, tenderness or itching, and same like IV cannula, central line and arterial line. Surrounding we have to see any bleeding or any redness or any itching. Coming to the Foley's catheterization, actually recommended days are 40 days, but in our ICU mostly we are changing catheterization below 7 days only, because to avoid urinary tract infection. Coming to the next, drug de-escalation. In this, the main issues we are seeing, high amount of dose. The high amount of dose can lead to patient's AKI. So maximum we have to reduce the dose and dilute more we have to give the patient. So higher level of antibiotic usage. Higher level of antibiotic uses, it's not helpful for the patient. And coming to the need, it changes from broad spectrum antibiotics to narrow spectrum antibiotics. See, suddenly if you start broad spectrum antibiotics and patient may develop AKI, and after that we can't do anything. So that is the reason we have to start narrow spectrum antibiotics, and after that we have to send for culture and sensitivity like blood culture, urine culture, ED culture. As per that growth of organism and sensitivity, broad spectrum antibiotics we have to start. And coming to the nurse's role. In this nurse's role, mainly we have to focus on resistance. So when the patient we are receiving, he got fever or any illness, directly we are starting broad spectrum antibiotics. This broad spectrum antibiotics will lead to any further infections. So in our nurse's role, we have to take culture samples from different sites, at least two and maximum three. So by taking culture also we have to follow sterile procedures for the contamination growth. So mainly after getting that culture report, we have to see the sensitivity and we have to start low spectrum antibiotics. And finally comes to the conclusion, fast Hugs Beat principle. And the main key points are encourages teamwork and improve the quality of care already we are giving in our ICUs, ensure patient safety, efficient care and effective care. That improves interventions to reduces the omission, increases compliance with evidence-based practices, improve outcome of efficient nursing care. And I hope you, all of you, understood this topic, I think so. And finally, in my side, I am encouraging you to give fast hugs beat to your patient in each shift every day. If you have any doubts, please comment me in text box. Thanking you.